Can everyone hear me? All right. Awesome. Hello, Santa Fe. My name is Jessica Fleck. I'm a Santa Fe Institute professor, and along with Caitlin McShay, who's in the front here, it's my pleasure to organize the Santa Fe Institute Community Lecture Series. Now, the last time we were all together, it was 2 years ago in February 2020 for Rajiv Sethi's lecture. And of course, the last couple years have been tough, to say the least. And this year doesn't look to be much better. We have before us, of course, a continuing global pandemic, climate change, and now a brutal invasion of a sovereign nation with both global hot and Cold War consequences, and many, most likely, unanticipated second-order effects. So as the poet Ilya Kaminsky, who was born in Odessa, wrote in Deaf Republic, at the trial of God, we will ask, why did you allow all this? And the answer will be an echo. Why did we allow all this? Over the last 2 years, SFI scientists produced a 700-page volume of essays edited by President David Krakauer and Emeritus President Jeffrey West that offers insights into how we might use understanding from complexity science, from complex systems, to eschew simplistic, one-size-fits-all solutions and grapple with the complex and messy nature of these challenges. It's really, it's available at Amazon, it's available on the SFI Science website, and it's really a lovely compendium that captures scientists thinking and struggling with these issues in real time. And I think it also provides a nice starting point for a conversation at the dinner table. You know, sometimes it can be uncomfortable and one doesn't know where to start, and there's many essays in this book that offer useful starting points. With respect to tonight's lecture, we have a fabulous group of speakers lined up for the 2022 series, and we hope you join us for each one. On behalf of the Santa Fe Institute, I'd like to thank the Santa Fe Reporter, the Lenzic Theater, of course, the NSF Research Coordination Network, all for their support. And in particular, I'd like to thank the McKinnon Family Foundation for underwriting the lecture series. So let's have a round of applause for everybody. Thank you. Now here to introduce tonight's lecture is SFI Professor Chris Kempes, who gave once in this series a lecture on astrobiology, and he's going to be introducing our speaker tonight. Thank you.
Thirty-five years ago, this lecture series began with a talk by SFI faculty member at the time, Stuart Kaufman, in which he discussed the origins of life. And so it is only fitting that we restart this series tonight by discussing related topics after 2 long years of the pandemic. The ideas that Kaufman spoke about then are connected to a current revolution in biology. It is a revolution of both perspective and of what types of questions can be answered. The questions are those of how did life begin? Where else could it be in the universe? How will we discover it or verify that it is not there at all? And how different could life be from what we already know? These are not easy questions. As longtime SFI external professor Harold Morowitz put it, to ask how life originated, we are going to be forced into the intellectual maze of defining life. The revolution in the shift in perspective that I mentioned is one that moves us from understanding life in terms of attributes of the diverse species we already know to one of the principles that all life anywhere in the universe share. This is a revolution of abstracting life and of looking for universal laws of life. The hope is that we can get to a science of life that is as universally applicable as what we have for chemistry and physics, two disciplines that allowed us to make discoveries far outside our own experiences on Earth. We must, again quoting Morowitz, look at the most general features of terrestrial biology and attempt to see the first step beyond the details of existing biochemistry. Our speaker tonight, Sarah Walker, is a leading light in this revolution. Sarah's work touches on an amazing breadth of topics in origins of life, astrobiology, artificial life, and synthetic biology. She brings new physical and mathematical theory to bear on everything from the algorithmic principles of life, to the structure of cellular networks, to what metabolism we should be looking for on Saturn's icy moon Enceladus, to quantifying the amount of construction it took to create an object in the hopes of separating life from non-life. All of these diverse topics share a common goal of finding the universal laws of life. Sarah is a professor at the Arizona State University, where she holds many appointments, including in the School of Earth and Space Exploration, where she is the associate director of the ASU SFI Center for Biosocial Complexity, and where she is the deputy director of the Beyond Center for Fundamental Concepts. She is also an external faculty member here at SFI. Her work has been widely recognized, and she recently won the Stanley L. Miller Early Career Award from the International Society of the Study of the Origin of Life. So please help me in welcoming Sarah Walker.
Hi. Hello, everyone. Thanks so much for coming tonight. I'm thrilled to be here. It's been a long time since I visited Santa Fe, and it's such a lovely city, so I've been having a delightful time. And so what I want to do tonight is kind of take us on an adventure and imagine what's possible if we actually come to understand what we are and what aliens are and what life is in the universe. So there's actually three questions that I'm really motivated by, and they're going to be kind of woven throughout the evening in our discussion as far as what we're going to be thinking about and how we can think about our place in the universe and how we can come to understand ourselves. So there, are we alone, which is obviously the aliens question. Is there anything else out there that's even remotely like us? What is life? This is the question that's actually the nearest and dearest to my heart, because I think if we don't answer this question, we're not going to be able to answer the other questions. And also, how does life originate, which is the main research driver of most of my career, is actually trying to answer how does non-life transition to life? And in order to answer that, you have to understand what life is. And in order to look for alien life, you have to understand what life is. And I think a lot of people really don't understand how deep this question actually cuts. And so what I'm hoping to do tonight is kind of paint a picture of the history of science and how we've progressed, how we think about this problem now, how we've thought about problems in the past and where we've come in the field of theoretical physics in particular, which my training is in, and then where we're going with trying to actually encompass our understanding of life and a more fundamental understanding of our place in the universe and what we are. So I wanted to start with the first question is, how will we even learn if there's others like us? And so I'm always kind of perplexed when I start talking about this question, because a lot of people actually think that we've already made first contact. So I'm just curious from the people in the audience today, and it would be really interesting also to get polls from people watching this later, but how many people think that we've already made contact with aliens? You can be honest, it's totally fine. I think it's a legitimate viewpoint to have. So there's a few people in the audience. Okay, great. So it is a very prescient vision on our cultural consciousness right now, this idea that alien life is out there. And many people, in the United States in particular, think that we've already made first contact. And of course that's coincident with sort of things that are happening in popular media. So the Pentagon, for example, recently released a report about unidentified aerial phenomena, suggesting potentially that some of them might be alien in origin. It was kind of an implicit assumption, but a lot of people have kind of run with this. There's entire online communities that are dedicated to uncovering the truth about these kind of phenomena. And we also have other sort of more in the cultural norms of the scientific community, discussions about possible technological artifacts from alien civilizations. So another example is Oumuamua, which was an object that came through our solar system very recently, which we know was originated from another star system. So this was actually really remarkable. It was the first object in human history that we've ever identified. We identified it with our telescopes that has come from another star system, right? We conjectured that such things could happen, but we never observed one. And so it's been popularly discussed, in particular by Abby Loeb, writing a very well-known book called Extraterrestrial, that this object might actually be extraterrestrial intelligence. It was a spaceship that came through our solar system. Right, so this has been also on our collective consciousness. There's also the whole topic of ancient aliens, right? So there's an entire TV series about this that has been on for many years. This is a painting that is 10,000 years old, which was found in India. And the anthropologist that found it conjectured that maybe what the ancients were drawing was a UFO. Looks a little bit like a UFO. There's other, if you Google it, ancient alien cave paintings, there will be all kinds of images that come up all across the earth that look very suggestive. So it's not necessarily new phenomena that we maybe have been thinking about alien life. But you could also ask, well, what are we projecting about the current cultural moment on ancient civilizations? So the thing that's very fascinating to me about this is that now, in this moment in history, the question of whether there's aliens out there is actually a scientific question. And the reason it's become a scientific question is actually not necessarily because the science has progressed, although the science has progressed, but also because it's culturally acceptable to talk about these things as legitimate scientific questions. And one of the reasons for that is actually because of a discovery made in 1996, which was the Allen Hills meteorite, which was a Martian meteorite that landed in Antarctica. It was recovered by scientists, and some scientists found suggested evidence of microbial life in this meteorite. So what I'm going to play for you right now is the first recording of a world leader ever announcing the discovery of alien life. So most people nowadays, you know, we're all interested. So some people believe we've already made contact. Some people think we'll never make contact. And one of the things I find really interesting is that we've already made contact so many times, at least culturally, that I'm not really sure exactly what the impact's going to be. So this is actually, you know, more than 20 years ago now, we have the first recording of a world leader announcing the discovery of alien life. Oh, it might not play.
Third, we are committed to the aggressive plant. This piece of rock was formed.
Okay, we'll start here.
It is well worth contemplating how we reached this moment of discovery. More than 4 billion years ago, this piece of rock was formed as a part of the original crust of Mars. After billions of years, it broke from the surface and began a 16 million year journey through space that would end here on Earth. It arrived in a meteor shower 13,000 years ago. And in 1984, an American scientist on an annual U.S. government mission to search for meteors on Antarctica picked it up and took it to be studied. Appropriately, it was the first rock to be picked up that year, rock number 84001. Today, rock 84001 speaks to us across all those billions of years and millions of miles. It speaks of the possibility of life. If this discovery is confirmed, it will surely be one of the most stunning insights into our universe that science has ever uncovered. Its implications are as far-reaching and awe-inspiring as can be imagined. Even as it promises answers to some of our oldest questions, it poses still others even more fundamental. We will continue to listen closely to what it has to say as we continue the search for answers and for knowledge that is as old as humanity itself, but essential to our people's future.
So I think, when I watch this video, I think how remarkable it is that we had such an announcement happen, and it's kind of, you know, it was a very passing cultural moment, right? So the science didn't pan out. We don't really think that the ALH meteorite was evidence of alien life, yet we had a standing U.S. president sit on the lawn of the White House and announce discovery of alien life in our past history. So I think this is very telling about where we sit historically and how we should be thinking about the quest for understanding alien life and where we are now and why this question is so important for our longevity and how we think about ourselves in the future. So I really like this idea of thinking about it being essential to our people's future. One of the things that was very important about that particular event in our history is that the federal government, at least in the United States, started investing in astrobiology as a serious discipline. So around the same time the NASA Astrobiology Institute was founded, NASA started heavily investing in the search for alien life as a potential scientific endeavor. So this was really a major transition in our quest to actually understand alien life as a scientific endeavor and actually having the federal government back it. And it wasn't actually almost for 20 years until that became part of the official, government-mandated NASA primary objectives to actually look for alien life. But this is part of the reason it's become a cultural norm for us to have these discussions. So I think it's really important to put that in context. And in fact, this has led to a lot of subsequent announcements of the detection of alien life. So what I've shown up here is actually an announcement from last year in 2021. How many people here actually remember this event happening? Okay, great. So quite a few people here. Obviously, we're a very selective audience. If you sort of polled the typical people, person on the street, they probably wouldn't know that there was a possible sign of life on Venus that was on the cover of the New York Times in 2021, but it was during the pandemic. And the signature here was a gas called phosphine, which some scientists had conjectured could only be produced by biology in the atmosphere of Venus. That has also subsequently become a very contentious issue. And the reason I'm bringing it up here is, for me personally, with what I'll be showing you a little bit later about how we need to think a little bit deeper about the nature of life and the kinds of questions that we're asking, looking for a gas that life on Earth produces is not a sufficient explanatory framework for identifying a phenomena that's like us. Phosphine is a very simple molecular gas. It may or may not be uniquely produced by life on Earth. That's kind of outstanding. But if I find a molecule in an atmosphere, it doesn't tell me anything about what life is or what life does as a unique phenomenon in the universe. And I think if we're asking the question, are we alone, that's really the question we're after. So even the science in some ways is falling short right now. And we can do better, but we also have to think about where we are historically. And so one of the things that's really fascinated me recently, as I'm kind of watching the cultural dialogues about UAPs, UFOs, Oumuamua, phosphine, everything else, is that the ways we talk about alien life right now are very primitive, and I don't mean that in a bad sense, I just mean it in an early developmental stage. We have a lot of transitions to go through as far as how we're going to understand what aliens are. I grew up in a house with a very Catholic mother, and she's a wonderful person. She always told me to think outside the box. But I always remember Joseph Campbell, who's a mythologist, a very famous one that wrote Hero of a Thousand Faces, which inspired the story of Star Wars, right? The Ark of the Hero. It's a story we've been telling for thousands and thousands of years over and over again. And the stories that we tell about ourselves and our place in the universe. And so I was listening to this because I just left my family's home coming here to Santa Fe, and I wanted to play a little clip because I think it's very relevant to thinking about the way we talk about aliens right now as a modern mythology. We're in the mythological phase of development in terms of our understanding of this problem. So this is a conversation between Joseph Campbell and Bill Moyers.
Simply trying to express a truth that can't be grasped any other way.
It's the edge, the interface between what can be known and what is never to be discovered, because it is a mystery transcendent of all human research. The source of life. What is it? No one knows.
So Joseph Campbell went around the world studying the world's mythologies and trying to understand how we think about ourselves and how we do it through the power of the stories that we tell. And even though he was talking about the Hero of a Thousand Faces, sort of the arc of the hero, I think aliens and the way that we talk about them are a very interesting mythology that we've carried with us through all of human history as far as how we think about the other and how we think about our place in the universe. And the dialogues that we're having now culturally are telling us something about how we're thinking about that problem and how we need to progress on it. And so what I want to do is kind of transition to thinking about how some of the stories that we told in ancient times have turned into a deeper understanding over thousands of years, right? We've done this many times with geometry, with understanding gravity, with understanding motion. Can we do that with understanding life? Aliens are modern mythology, but it doesn't mean that we can't understand them in the future. It just means that we need to build new narratives about how we understand the world and how we understand ourselves. So I want to transition now from thinking about sort of the modern dialogue we're having to thinking about the past and thinking about sort of the long arc of human progress and how we've developed as a species into the amazing technological, I don't know what to call us, but we're just brilliant, right? The minds that exist on this planet right now are probably one of the most exceptional things that exists in the entire universe, in my opinion. I'm obviously very biased, being a member of that group, but I think it's quite extraordinary how far we've come. But I think about, you know, ancient peoples looking up at the heavens and trying to make stories to make sense of their world. And, you know, whatever culture you go to, there's all kinds of stories about stars in the heavens or planets in the heavens being governed by human-like entities or some kind of intelligence or all of these kind of things that we used to discuss. But eventually we started to try to actually develop theories and mathematical laws that helped us understand those phenomena. It doesn't mean that those explanations are better, but it does mean that there's more predictive and explanatory in certain ways, not always. And so one of the earliest things that we started to think about was actually planetary motion, right? So we have the stars in the night sky that were once thought to be governed by, you know, sort of immovable on a celestial sphere, at least in certain cultures. But every once in a while, there would be these wandering stars that would kind of move across the sky in weird ways. And so what I'm showing here is the path of Mars, which has been known for thousands of years to have retrograde motion. So every once in a while, it goes backwards. And in ancient times, we came up with models for that. One of the most famous models was Ptolemy's epicycles. So this is a geocentric model for the universe. Earth was at the center. And it revolved around the idea that perfect spheres were the only possible motion for the heavens, because the ancient Greeks had actually just recently invented the circle. It seemed to be a perfect object that exists, you know, in some other realm, a Platonic realm of mathematical objects. And therefore, heavenly motion was probably described by circles. Those are all sort of reasonable assumptions based on the time and our understanding of the world in which we lived. But in order to make that model work, you had to add circles inside of circles. So Mars would go on an orbit in a circle that was centered on another circle that actually went around the Earth. And that's what an epicycle is. And in order to get more accurate predictions of planetary motion, not just Mars, over the centuries, people would add more circles inside of circles. So this was a very predictive model, but it wasn't very explanatory. If I tried to take this model, if I had imagined at that time in human history there could be other planetary systems, and I had taken this model to those other planetary systems, it wouldn't work. It wasn't actually explanatory what was happening, but it told me how to describe the data. So what was actually required to understand heavenly motion? Well, that actually took the convergence of centuries of thought across multiple areas of human endeavor. And the two I'm going to highlight now are just the emergence of geometry as a concept and the emergence of time, in particular, actually being able to accurately track time. So geometry was invented based on that, originally from trying to think about surveying the Earth. Geo actually comes from the word Earth, and metry is metric, right? So measuring the Earth. Early geometers were surveyors. They surveyed the landscape, and they wanted to try to figure out how tall a mountain was. And then we developed this idea of this abstract concept of triangles and spheres and translation in space and the fact that we could talk about motion of an object relative to a fixed background. And it took centuries to develop those concepts. Time, things we take for granted. Like, I can look at my watch right now. Probably many of you in the room can look at your watch and see seconds passing. The first seconds that we could actually measure on a clock took centuries of development of clocks. The first clocks were made of elements of the earth. They were made of sand. They were made of shadows. They were made of water. Then we figured out how to build mechanical devices that could actually mechanize tracking time. And eventually we got them so accurate with pendulums, we could track seconds. Seconds were a human invention. They didn't always exist in our history. They were not something we could track. And Tycho Brahe used the fact that we could measure seconds to actually accurately track planetary motion to a precision that we never thought was possible before. And because he had accurate motions of that Mars retrograde motion, its exact position in the night sky, and the exact time to the second of where it was, Kepler could come up with his laws of planetary motion. Kepler's laws were really important because he formalized mathematically that planets moved in ellipses, not perfect circles. And his model required the sun was at the center. And it had other mathematical properties that were very surprising, potentially, to the ancients if they had known of these properties. What that allowed was a gentleman named Isaac Newton to come along and actually formalize what we call the laws of motion and the laws of gravitation. So we see motion everywhere. I'm moving across the stage right now. If we were outside, we might see a satellite moving across the night sky. If I drop something, it'd move. All of those things are connected by a common concept of motion through space, which was one of the concepts that Newton formalized. But the more important one, I think, as far as thinking about the history, the progression of this set of ideas, is that he unified the motion in the heavens with the motion on Earth. For most of human history, and Galileo played a large role in this too, so there's never an isolated intellect in any period in history. But the important unification that they made is to think about planetary motion and the things that happen in the night sky as actually being governed by the same principles as what happens on Earth. That was a major innovation in our thought. And so in the words of Isaac Asimov, we all know we fall, right? Every child falls. I fell earlier today. It's a kind of normal human event. But Newton's discovery was that the moon falls. The moon is constantly falling. And it does by the same rules we do, right? I mean, how would you come to that level of understanding of the world without being able to have this cultural evolution of this set of ideas and development of human thought? And of course, more recently, we've gotten an even deeper understanding of that. So I can sit up here, or stand, I guess I'm standing, I'm not sitting, and tell you that I'm standing on the stage because I'm standing in a gravitational potential well. The curvature of space and time around me is actually why I sit fixed here and why you're all sitting fixed in your seat. That idea came from Einstein, who was actually thinking about very different physical phenomena. He started by thinking about the properties of light and the constancy of speed of light. And then he derived that gravity, this force that Newton invented to describe the motion of planets in the night sky and our motion on Earth, was actually the result of the curvature of the fabric of space-time in the presence of massive bodies. And that's our current understanding of why we're all sitting in the room for some aspects of that, but not all aspects. And that obviously was, you know, part of the genius of Einstein. Now, one of the things that was really interesting about Einstein's theories is that they predicted phenomena that we had never, ever dreamed possible before. And one of the phenomena I think was most interesting was gravitational waves. So these were hypothetical. In 1915, Einstein was dreaming up the possible existence of gravitational waves with horse-drawn carriages. The technology of the day was totally different than it is now. And we did not make first contact with the phenomena that he predicted existed for 100 years. So gravitational waves have been permeating this planet as long as we've been here. They are ripples in the fabric of space-time that happen because of the interaction of very massive bodies. But they're very weak effects because gravity is a very weak force. And so they're almost minuscule in their ability to actually sort of affect our everyday experience. They don't affect our everyday experience, but they exist in our universe. And so in order to go from Einstein in the era that he lived all the way to actually detecting the phenomena he predicted, it took 100 years of technological development. And the machine that we came up with is called an interferometer. This is a picture of LIGO, the Large Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory. I think I got that right. So the arms of light, there's actually two LIGO instruments located in different parts of the United States. The arms that you see in the instrument are 4 kilometers long, and that's necessary because in order to detect a gravitational wave event, you have to detect something that's about, would vibrate a proton about a tenth of its width. So it's an effect about the tenth of the width of a proton. So you need a huge instrument to be able to actually detect that. And in fact, they're super sensitive, so they have to actually take out the noise from like nearby cars and things like that. But in 2015, after we built this instrument, remember, it took 100 years of development technology to get here, millions of dollars, lots of smart people, many generations of scientists. We detected an event in 2015 of a black hole merger, an event that happened 1.4 billion years in our past. That gravitational wave had been traveling across our universe for 1.4 billion years until it was picked up by our gravitational wave detector. And we had confirmation that that phenomena existed, first contact of humanity with the phenomena of gravitational waves. So why am I talking about this example in particular with reference to alien life? I use the word first contact directly, purposefully to be kind of provocative, right? Aliens, we don't know what we're actually making contact with. We don't know what we are. We don't know what we are as a general phenomenon in the universe, so we don't know what aliens are going to be like. There's an idea that's popularly discussed. It comes from Robin Hanson in discussions about alien life called the Great Filter. The Great Filter is supposed to be an explanation for something called the Fermi Paradox. The Fermi Paradox is an idea originally sort of said cheekily by Enrico Fermi in a lunch discussion that if aliens are out there, you know, where are they? Why don't we see them? So it's supposed to be a paradox that if alien life is common in the universe, we don't see any of it. And therefore, probably life is rare. Maybe we're the only life in the universe. The Great Filter is a proposed solution to the Fermi Paradox, which says there's some filter in the evolution of a life form from the original life all the way up to a technological civilization that most examples of life in the universe, most biospheres, will not pass. There's a great extinction event. It could be the origin of life is hard, and the origin of life is the Great Filter. It could be nuclear holocaust or something equivalent happens predictably, sorry for a bad example, on lots of planets. I don't really believe that's true, so I'm an eternal optimist. But this idea that intelligent civilizations just wipe themselves out, and so we don't see them because they've already extinguished themselves. And this becomes relevant for talking about our own longevity. It's actually an existential question because our long-term future depends on where the Great Filter is. If it's in our past, hooray for us, we've made it through. If it's in our future, oh boy, we better look out. Or at least that's how people talk about it. But for me, I think I've always thought the Fermi Paradox a little perplexing and a little bit premature because I always think we don't know what we're looking for. We don't know what this phenomena is. How would we possibly recognize it when we see it? And if you think about the example of gravitational waves, they've always been there. Space-time, if it is the way that we currently understand it, has always been there. But we haven't always understood them in the way we have. That took a lot of evolution. In fact, it took 4 billion years of evolution on this planet and several thousand years of learning and evolution culturally in our minds and societally for us to come to understand those phenomena. So maybe the filter is not actually a physical filter, it's a perceptual filter. In the sense that in order to see certain features of the reality we live in, we have to advance enough as a civilization to actually come to that understanding. And I can cite a couple examples which are pretty clear cut of what I mean. So, for example, there has been a hidden world of aliens all around us most of our history, which are microbial life. We didn't know microbes were there, you know, for millions of years. It took the invention of the microscope, which allows us to see magnifications much larger than our eye, to see these tiny microbes that are actually the things that are causing the mold on our bread. They're everywhere. We now know they're everywhere. But we couldn't see them. We didn't know they were there. We had indirect evidence, but not direct evidence. The same with telescopes. Telescopes are another example based on the architecture of our eye that allow us to see an entire universe that we didn't know was there previously. So imagine being Galileo, taking the telescope to look at Jupiter and seeing the moons of Jupiter, being the first human in history to recognize that those are moons orbiting another planetary body. No idea what they were there. We can think more recently about exoplanets, right? So for most of human history until the early 1990s, we had no idea there were planets around other stars. We could guess they were there. We could make models. We might have some, you know, cursory evidence they might be there. But the actual confirmation we didn't get until we built instruments sophisticated enough, technology sophisticated enough to allow us to see it was there. So it is possible that maybe we just don't have the technology, we don't have the knowledge to recognize aliens. We don't know what we are. So this is my question. I love this question. I think it's the most pressing question of our time. I think a lot of people don't think it's the most pressing. Obviously, there's a lot of existential questions about our survival, the sort of existential questions about our day-to-day existence. I'm a mom of two, and you know, most of my time I think actually about taking care of my kids. But when I have the liberty of thinking deep thoughts and thinking long term, this is my favorite question. Which is, what is life? What are we? And so the quote I have up here is actually from Erwin Schrödinger, who is a very famous physicist of the last century, a very prominent figure in the founding of quantum mechanics. But he had this very popular set of lectures he gave in 1943 at the Dublin Institute for Advanced Study with the title, What is Life?, which he turned into a book. That book was very popular. It's become hugely influential. It influenced Watson and Crick actually to look for the structure of DNA, which they discovered along with Rosalind Franklin. And, you know, I don't know how many countless dozens, maybe hundreds of physicists to actually focus on this problem. And so his question was, how can events in space and time, which take place within the spatial boundary of a living cell, be accounted for by physics and chemistry? How can we actually explain this phenomena of life with what we know right now in physics and chemistry? And his conclusion in 1943, oops, sorry, was that we can't. He did a lot of really interesting intellectual exercises in that book where he actually tried to look at what we know of life and what we know of physics and trying to explore their compatibility, and he proposed a lot of really interesting ideas. But my absolute favorite quote from that book is this one which he had toward the end, which is, living matter, while not eluding the laws of physics as established up to date, is likely to involve other laws of physics hitherto unknown. And so this is sort of my play on Schrodinger's question, which is, life is what? And sometimes I put a question mark there because I think we're going to be so surprised when we get to that answer. I mean, imagine explaining to people hundreds or thousands of years ago or millions of years ago, if we had the right language to even communicate, what the world is like today, the knowledge that we have today. So I think we need to be ready, and we need to be creative, and we need to think out of the box about this question, because we need to be prepared to be surprised by the answer. Even though we're life, I think there's this giant misconception, because we're life, we understand it more than other things. But we actually understand more right now about the atoms in your body than we do about you as a living thing. And that, to me, is rather shocking and rather fun, because it means that we have a mystery to solve. So what can we explain with current physics? So we have a lot of brilliant physical theories that have been developed. And I'm talking fundamental physics. So I'm trained in theoretical physics. I'm very romanticized by the idea that there's very simple mathematical laws that describe the world. And if we get to a sufficient level of abstraction, like the idea of space-time and Einstein's laws of gravity and what Newton did, or with quantum mechanics, that we can explain a lot. And you'll notice with like very fundamental theories that their explanatory reach is very broad. So what do I mean by that? I mean Newton's laws of motion explain every moving object, right? That is their explanatory reach. So it's the fact that we understand the laws of gravitation and the ideas Newton had 300 years ago that allows us to launch satellites into space today, right? Without that knowledge, we wouldn't be able to do that transformation. So those kind of explanations are really powerful and important. And one of the arguments that I think is kind of lacking in discussion about applicability of the known laws of physics to life is that, of course, the known laws of physics should apply to life. We exist in the physical universe. But it doesn't mean that it explains us. And what I mean by that is there's this great example by Daniel Dennett, who's a philosopher that mostly focuses on consciousness and related things, but he has this really fun essay called Herding Cats and Free Will Inflation, which is mostly about the problem of free will, where he makes an analogy between a skier moving downhill and rocks moving downhill, right? Rocks are kind of, they don't have any agency. They blindly follow the laws of motion, the laws of gravitation. They're just bumbling down the hill. If you watch an expert skier, someone that has a lot of experience skiing, they have a lot of causal control over the actions and how they're moving down that slope. That's what agency is. It's an ability to control your motions. Of course, the skier is also obeying the laws of gravitation, but there's something else going on. It's not the same kind of motion as with the rock. And so I think it's fine to say there's no conflict with life and the current laws of physics. And this will be the canonical argument that people will make. In fact, we were having this argument over dinner last night, which was really fun. Life doesn't violate any of the known laws of physics. But my point is, it's not explained by them either. We don't have a solution to the origin of life. We don't know how to look for alien life. We don't know how to predict the evolution of the biosphere or the technosphere or where we're going next. If we had a theory that explained what we are, we would be able to do all those things. It's not sufficiently explanatory, and we can debate that. I think it would be fun to get in the questions about, you know, these sorts of arguments, but I think this is where sort of the crux of the distinction is. You either think there's something fundamentally new and different going on in life, or you don't. But I think if you don't, then how do you explain any of the features of life, and how do you actually solve the origin of life if you don't think that there's something new and different going on? So You know, I've given sort of a very narrow summary of a little bit of history of physics. There's obviously a huge history of physics. There's a huge history of human thought that I don't have enough time, you know, I wouldn't have enough time in multiple lifetimes to even understand, let alone review in a simple lecture. But what I want to point out is when we think about the history of physics, at least, you know, these grand fundamental theories that seem to describe a lot and we want to use to really understand what we are and our place in the universe, we've gone through several unifications over the history of the progression of this body of knowledge. And this is a list that was compiled by Frank Wilczek, who's a Nobel laureate in physics, in a really nice essay he wrote on physics in the next 100 years. And I've talked about some of these unifications. So in particular, I talked about the unification of terrestrial and celestial physics by Newton and Galileo, right? So that first moment in history, or series of moments, when we came to understand that celestial motion was the same as terrestrial motion. And also space and time by Einstein and also Minkowski working in parallel on a lot of the mathematics. So what I'm going to get into for the second part of my talk is thinking about what unification is actually going to be necessary to explain life. So this is obviously very much a conjecture. We don't know how to solve this problem. I wouldn't be standing up here talking about it the way I am if we knew how to solve it. But for me, I think what's interesting is thinking about what is the next century of physics going to actually unfold for our understanding about this particular problem. And you'll note that the major unification of the last century, besides what the work of Einstein thinking about space and time and also waves and particles, was actually things that seem like they have nothing to do with physics, which was unifications by Alan Turing and George Boole on reasoning and calculation. So we invented something called computation in the last century, which was basically trying to take how we think human minds work and abstracting that in such a way that we could input that in machines. That's what we call computers. That's reasoning and calculation made into a mathematical theory that allows us to do computation. And that was the invention of modern computers, which completely revolutionized our planet. And so we also have an understanding of matter, which comes from our history of physics. But I don't think that we have an understanding of what those two things are as the same thing. What is computation, if you think about computation and matter as the same thing? And most of our unifications in the history of physics have actually taken things that seem completely different and looked at them at a deeper level of description and realized they're the same thing. And so this is, I think, where we need to go with trying to understand life. So we have the laws of physics we know and love, or at least some of us love. If we were trained in physics, not everybody loves the laws of physics enough to put an emoji up, but some of us do. And so some of those laws describe matter and light. Those are the theories that we currently discuss in terms of quantum mechanics, the standard model of particle physics, or the core theory, depending on how you talk about it. Laws of large numbers and observational certainty. This evolved in the 1800s with thermodynamics and statistical mechanics. We have laws of space and simultaneity in mechanics. This is special relativity and general relativity in its current incarnation. What's next? What don't we understand? And I'm going to suggest that what we don't understand, which is also what's going to be the physics that ultimately explains what life is the laws of information or the laws of what's possible. And I will explain, hopefully, what that means. And I'm going to do it by example. And so I've already mentioned the fact that we can only launch satellites into space right now because we've discovered something called the laws of gravitation. If you think about what the laws of gravitation are, they're a mathematical formula we write on paper, right? But they're actually much more than that. That's just a representation of that phenomena that we find very easy to communicate between some of us. Not all of us are obviously, you know, love mathematics. Some of us don't like communicating that way, but some of us do. When you think about the sort of what is the law of gravitation and how did it emerge on our planet, it took 4 billion years nearly of evolution of life on the planet to evolve something that we call intelligent physical systems like us. And we basically identified regularities in the physical world that we identify as gravitation, and we wrote those down symbolically in the laws of motion and gravity. And because we have that knowledge now, we have this very compressed representation of this broad class of physical phenomena that we observe in the world, we can now do amazing things like launch satellites into space or fly airplanes or do all kinds of things that were previously impossible in human history. And so a planet like ours with satellites orbiting it doesn't exist unless you actually have the knowledge to launch those satellites into space. And knowledge is a really interesting thing because it's a very reliable kind of physics, right? So Mars has a couple moons, a couple satellites orbiting it, but they're captured asteroids. We have one moon that happened because of a cataclysmic event in our early history, but we have thousands of satellites. We could launch 10 more today, we could launch 100 the next day if we wanted to. We can launch a satellite every day. Because that knowledge is now memory in our system, is part of the intrinsic sort of fabric that is us as a civilization on this planet, it's become a very reliable kind of physical process. Even those satellites themselves around terrestrial planets might be very rare, right? But metal boxes around a planet that has technology and knowledge of the laws of gravitation is maybe a very probable thing. Another example is to think about the periodic table of the elements, which you can organize by all of the physical events in the universe that can produce those elements. So a few elements like hydrogen and helium were formed just after the Big Bang. Other heavier elements started forming in the deaths of massive stars. So you may have heard sort of the pop culture science meme that we're all stardust, right? So a lot of the elements in our bodies like carbon and oxygen and, you know, all these sort of heavier elements, metals, as astronomers call them, were produced in the deaths of stars. But if you get to the highest atomic number elements, the most reliable process we know of in the universe that can produce them is technology. So things like transuranium elements, all the way up to 118, which is magnesium, which is the highest atomic number element that we've been able to synthesize in the laboratory. The places in the universe that we know that those elements can be produced in high abundance are in labs on Earth. Why is that? Because we have knowledge of nuclear physics and we can control the boundary conditions of the experimental setup to actually synthesize those elements in high abundance. They are extremely improbable series of events, but we control those boundary conditions to make them highly probable and make them in high abundance. So life, whatever it is, acquiring information about the physical world to do these improbable things is a really interesting phenomena. And I purposefully, explicitly use anthropocentric examples as a tool to point out why current physics fails at explaining these things. Because in order to explain the probability of magnesium on the surface of Earth, or the thousands of satellites orbiting Earth, you actually have to have, as part of your causal explanation, a system that has knowledge of the laws of physics. So the laws of physics themselves are insufficient. They're part of the explanation, but they're not the whole explanation. They're part of the causal chain to produce those events. So this gets at something really interesting, which is there's been this sort of long and sordid relationship between physics and mathematics. Right? We don't know if mathematics is more fundamental or physics is more fundamental. That goes all the way back to Plato's cave. Right? Is the abstract the real physical thing and we just kind of embody abstractions, or, and do mathematical objects have an existence outside of us? Why do the laws of physics, the mathematical equations that we actually write down, why are those the ones that correspond to the real world? Right? Why do certain words work in certain contexts and certain words don't work? Physical thing somewhere. So you can think of this a little bit like a version of the multiverse scenario, where you want to explain all of reality by saying all of reality is just math. And every mathematical equation, like a law of gravitation or a law of quantum, like the mathematical form of equations of quantum mechanics, or the sort of tensor field theory that we use for gravity, all of those things are mathematical objects that correspond to a physical reality somewhere. So this is one possible solution, but I always found, like, if you want to explain everything, you want to explain the things we observe by saying everything should exist, you end up explaining almost nothing about why the particular features of our universe exist. So you're still left with this ultimate question, which is, what or who, I guess I should say whom, decides what exists? And for me, this is actually really the most interesting question of all the questions in physics, is why do some things exist and not others? Why am I holding clicky thing. I don't know what these are called. What are they called? But instead of some other electronic device that might perform similar function, why is it this particular architecture? Why does a computer exist? Why am I here? Why do stars form the way they do? And I think this is a question that physics is actually not prepared to address. But we do have some theories that try to attempt to address it. And I think the best bet we have is actually Darwin's theory of natural selection or its subsequent modifications, because selection is basically saying these things get to exist, but not these, because they were selected. There was some evolutionary filter that filtered them out. So maybe some mathematical equations exist because there's some sort of overarching evolutionary principle for universes, and people in cosmology have actually proposed this idea that the universe is learning its own laws. But if we want to just sort of contrast thinking about life and biology and selection and the idea that some things exist on our planet, but not all the things that could possibly, we don't have all possible technologies, we don't have all possible humans or all possible kinds of animal, we don't have all possible kinds of molecule, only some things. That's basically explained by evolutionary contingency, because there's a historical dependency in terms of the way we think evolutionarily about what exists on our planet now in the great tree of life relative to what's existed in the past. And of course, the great problem of the origin of life is that we think all of life on Earth as it exists now is united in the past. We all share a common ancestry. So of course, there's the idea that humans share a common ancestry in the past, but even the microbes in your gut, pretty much everything that you've ever encountered as a biological system, everything, we think had a common ancestor in the past that we call this last universal common ancestor. What Darwin noted, which I think is one of the most important distinctions between physics as we have it right now and the standard canon of physics, and what's necessary to explain the phenomena of life, is captured really eloquently. I think this is the nicest thing that he ever wrote. I actually tried to read Darwin recently, and he wasn't as eloquent a writer for the rest of the things. I was really surprised. I was like, I was sold on a lie. I thought Darwin was a brilliant writer. But he writes, whilst this planet has gone cycling on according to the fixed law of gravity, from so simple a beginning, endless forms most beautiful and most wonderful have been and are being evolved. So we have Newtonian mechanics where in those kind of theories, and actually most theories of physics are structured this way, they start with some initial conditions. So you could put the planets in a particular motion, and you know the law of gravity, and you know the law of gravity doesn't ever change in time, and you set the system in motion, you can describe it forever. What Darwin says is no, that doesn't work for life, because what we see in life is evolution. Every form is generating the next, and we just see an endless creation of new forms and an endless generation of diversity, and an endless sort of propagation of some of that information into the future, but not all of it. Darwin's theory is about the propagation of information in the universe. Newton's theory says nothing about it, because he says all of the information that was put in the universe was put in the initial condition. And of course, that's an artifact of his time, because one of Newton's goals was to describe a universe where the laws came from the outside, because he was envisioning that there was some law-like entity that lived outside of the universe that sent it in motion. Darwin saw the universe itself as being the creative process. It was generating all the novelty and the diversity and the beauty via its own structures. It was coming internally. Now, one of the things that comes out interesting by looking at this dichotomy is the fact that we cannot think about the fundamental unit of life as being the individual. This has been a major misnomer in people's attempts to define life. People want to define life in terms of a cell. Even when I quoted Schrodinger, that first slide, what is the physics and chemistry that defines what happens within the boundary of a living cell? We might try to define what happens within the boundary of an individual. An individual is alive. What Darwin was hinting at is that it's the lineages, because we're talking about the endless forms that are being generated. I am actually a representation of that, because even as an individual, I'm not made of the same physical stuff that I was 10 years ago, and neither are you. You have to eat every day. You're adding matter to your body. You have some information in your body, your DNA, your pattern that is you, that is constantly re-imprinting itself on matter. You're actually a lineage of information across time over a human life through your development from an embryo all the way up to an adult. Through your entire life, what is continuity about you is not the actual atoms in your body. It's something else. It's something about that progression, that propagation of information across time. It's not about the individual. It's about that propagation. So you can think about that over an individual lifetime, but you can also think about that over the evolution of the biosphere as a whole. Life is about these lineages of propagating information, as Michael Lockman, who's a professor at Santa Fe Institute, would say. Michael's been really inspiring to me on this point because he thinks about the fundamental unit as these lineages. And when I describe what life is, from the perspective I've come to understand it, is that life is the physics of how information structures matter across space and time. If you want to talk about an example of life, you can't talk about you or me as an individual because we're all connected through a common evolutionary history, a common culture, all kinds of common informational structures that we're constantly exchanging information between us. What we are part of that's common is there was some event that happened early in the evolution of our planet we call the origin of life, where we transitioned to this kind of physics, and the evolution of our biosphere, the structure of what's happened over that 4 billion years, is an example of life. And that includes all of the artifacts we produce. My computer that I'm giving this presentation off of would not exist on this planet right now if there wasn't 4 billion years of biological evolution to precede it. It's a direct consequence of it. It's an example of the physics of life actually being implemented in our universe. Computers don't spontaneously fluctuate out of the vacuum. I would never spontaneously fluctuate out of the vacuum. I require an evolutionary history to create me, and in fact, I would never exist in isolation. I would have to exist with all of you because we're part of a common evolutionary history. So if we go back to thinking about the laws we know and love and where we sit, for me, what's next is to think about this, to think about the fact that we are actually part of a lineage of information. We're part of a common causal structure that unites all life on this planet, and we need to understand the features of that history and start thinking in new ways about the physics that might describe that. And I want to just give a nod to the fact that there's actually a lot of different ways that people talk about this. There's a ton of people at Santa Fe Institute in particular thinking from a complex systems science perspective and thinking information theoretically about it, with information theory of individuality and all kinds of other interesting theories about what's next. Stephen Wolfram has a physics project trying to think about computation as fundamental to physics. There is a philosophical project right now which is, you know, on the boundary between theory and physics called constructor theory, which I think gets at similar ideas. And there's some interesting things happening in quantum gravity with causal set theories of quantum gravity that also have similar ideas. But what I'm going to talk about is assembly theory, which is the theory I work on, which is explicitly tied to trying to understand the origins of life and how we detect aliens, which is trying to capture some of these missing principles that are not accounted by our current laws of physics but might explain features of what we are. And so this goes back to now thinking about the origin of life itself. If we want to understand that transition from a Newtonian description of the world to a Darwinian description of the world as being a problem of unification, we have to think about what is it when we say that information, this idea that ideas, abstract things like laws of gravitation or words, or information encoded in a genome that's not about the specific structure of DNA but the relationship of the sequence of bits in DNA to other objects in a cell, what does it mean when we take those abstract things and we try to make them physical? What do they look like when they're physical objects? Right? I mean, this goes back thousands of years. Like Plato's cave, we've always tried to separate the abstract from the physical. We think the abstract, the things that exist in our mind as representations of reality, are not physical things. But they obviously represent physical things, and they're deeply intrinsic to what we are and what we do. I'm really interested in the idea of a theoretical physics of theoretical physicists. I think it's really cool to think about what if we're in the system and we're trying to describe what we are in the system. And I think this kind of idea of thinking about what's the unification that's going to allow that. In fact, I love this quote from Roger Penrose, which is, I don't like the word materialist because it suggests we know what the material is. Roger Penrose is a very prominent physicist. And you know, as physicists, I've been accused of scientism. It's a word. You know, like an overbelief in science, but I don't think that's actually accurate. I think it's an overbelief in being ability to answer open questions. And I think one of the things you have to be open-minded to is what do we accept from what we've been taught, and what do we actually try to figure out how to think new. And so this quote is for me saying we need to be open-minded about the fact that even though we have a good description of matter in elementary particle physics, maybe we really don't understand the bedrock of reality when we get to life. Maybe it's a much more complex picture than that. And in fact, there's a lot of scientists out there that think when we get to this description, physics, you know, there's this typical hierarchy where it's like math, physics, chemistry, biology, you know, and the philosophy is off to the side. Which just totally doesn't make sense. I mean, disciplines are things that we invented. They don't really exist. But you know, there's a whole contingent of people that are trying to contradict that and say, like, biology is the bigger class and physics is, as we know it, is a subclass of whatever biology is, right? So I think this is kind of, you know, interesting to start thinking about is how do we reinvent how we even think about really basic concepts? So I'm now going to kind of transition into talking more about the kind of science that I actually work on. So I think the most important thing in all of this is to focus on the questions and focus on the big picture goals and focus on long-term thinking, because I don't think that we have a long enough arc in our discussions about any of the topics that we're addressing sort of existentially right now, aliens being one of them. And so for me, obviously biased, being trained as a theorist, I think theories play an incredibly important role in thinking about long-term questions. Because theories give us explanatory frameworks, and if they're good theories, they have really broad explanatory reach. So I mentioned Newton's laws of motion, right? They explain anything that's moving. It doesn't matter if it's a cat, a bat, a thingamajigger, a continuum transfunctioner. I don't know, I'm just making stuff up. That's not a made-up thing, it's from a movie, but which is a funny movie. But anyway, you know, everything that moves, Starlink, it explains everything that moves. So what would be a broad enough theory? It has to be really abstract. So this is the thing that's really interesting. If you want to understand a really broad class of phenomena, life is a very broad class of phenomena, especially if you want to consider microbes as life, us as life, my computer as representative of the same physics, even if you don't want to say my computer's alive, I don't think it's alive like I am, but I do think it's definitely a product of an evolutionary process. You want to unify all of that under the same umbrella. It's got to be a pretty abstract set of ideas. So I think Tegmark is onto the right idea. I think Max has, well, he's a really bright guy. He's got a lot of interesting insights to think about the possibility space of everything. I think this problem of, like, what are all the things that could exist or we could imagine to exist is a really powerful framing for thinking about why we see certain things. But I think mathematics and technology are far too abstract. They are things that exist at our level. We invented them. People think mathematics is discovered. I'm much more in the camp of thinking it was invented by human minds, and it might be different in other architectures. But I think math has really interesting properties, like it's very copyable between different physical media, which is why we think math is such a reliable description. Because if I give you an equation and you're mathematically literate, you understand exactly what I mean. If I tell you the sky is blue, you might ask me, is it an azure blue or a deep cobalt blue, right? Like that's much more subjective. So math is a really great way of parsing how we talk about reality for a lot of reasons. But if we want to think about the physics of the possibility space, what is possible to exist in our universe, the most concrete place we have to think about that is actually molecules in chemistry. Because chemistry is the first kind of system, if we think about scales of reality, moving from the smallest things to the biggest things, it's the first scale where we have such huge combinatorial diversity that everything that could exist cannot actually exist because there aren't enough resources. So if you think about an elementary particles, we have a certain set. We've got electrons, protons, neutrons, you know, all sort of the baryons and you know, hadrons and all those things in the standard model of particle physics, right? There's a certain set of them. And even for elements, we've made 118 of them. They seem to kind of be a finite set because the laws of physics don't really allow us to keep producing higher and higher atomic number elements. It gets really hard for various physical constraints that exist in our universe. When you get to chemistry and you have carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, phosphorus, sulfur, so the main elements life uses, and you start combining them, you want to just make small molecules. Say just a molecule that's the size about an amino acid or two amino acids. So proteins are made of amino acids. They're just like the single units that make up proteins. You think about like a single unit that makes up a DNA, like the sort of alphabet of DNA. If you get to that molecular weight, very small molecules, there's over 10 to the 60 possibilities that cheminformaticians, people that study chemical space, have actually conjectured to exist. There are not enough resources in the universe to make one copy of every one of those molecules. Even if you think of a protein that catalyzes reactions in your cell, and you want to make every possible variation of a protein, there are not enough resources in the universe to do it. Something interesting happens in chemistry, because the number of possibilities is so large, you can never ever realize all of them. And in fact, one of the first people to really eloquently point that out was Stu Kaufman, who was the first person to give this lecture series. So it's something that we observe in chemistry, but we don't really understand how to get a handle on. And so what we're doing in thinking about this vastness of chemical space is to think about the physical structures we observe. So this is a movie of one particular molecule. And I have it, I borrowed this slide from my colleague Lee Cronin at the University of Glasgow. So Lee is actually the original inventor of the theory I'm going to work on, because he's a chemist and he works with molecules, and he realized there was something really interesting about the way to think about chemical space if you want to solve the origin of life. So chemical space is the space of all possible molecules. And what you think is, or what we think, and the way we talk about it is when life emerges, life is, if you want to solve the origin of life, it's like a search problem, like a Google search. You need an algorithm that allows you to search chemical space for life in that space. Which configurations of molecules actually allow life to exist in those configurations of molecules? But the interesting thing is chemical space is absolutely huge. So I mentioned that number 10 to the 60. In fact, I like to compare, so we're kind of trained culturally to think about the vastness of physical space, right? So in the background here is shown the Hubble Deep Field, and you know, each little dot in here is a galaxy that's billions of years away, and the universe is, you know, many billions of years across. The amount of stuff, like unique kinds of objects that can be made on our planet, is denser and more rich than anywhere else that we know of in the universe. The possible molecule space, right? So chemists working in labs around the Earth today can make more kinds of molecules than ever possible in the history of our planet, and more kinds of molecules than we know of that can be made on any other planet. So the molecule shown here is Taxol. It's an anti-cancer drug. Some of these molecules can only be produced by technology. They're not even invented by biology, because they require so many particular steps for their synthesis that you actually have to know what you're doing to make them. And in fact, we have to actually build AI now to invent new drugs, because we need better algorithms for searching this space for biologically compatible molecules. So what we're trying to do is actually understand the structure of this space of what's possible. What is the physics of what's possible as it looks like in chemical space? And can we use that same kind of understanding to understand what we are? Because we are also things that exist in this high combinatorial space of what's possible. You want to think about all possible technologies. It's almost impossible to imagine what all possible technologies are. It might be impossible. What are all possible personality traits for a human? What are all possible configurations of this room? Right? Once you get into high combinatorial diversity spaces, the possibility space is just exponentially growing as the number of building blocks you have in that system. So chemistry is the first place we see that, but then you start moving molecules together to make cell-like structures, or to even make, you know, larger macromolecules. And then those cells form society, or well, they form multicellular structures, and then societies, and then things like us. So at each level, you get an increasing explosion of the number of possibilities, and somehow we've carved a particular path through that. So how do we understand that structure? So what we're doing is developing a theory called assembly theory, which is first validated in molecules. So it's supposed to be a general theory, but it's very important to acknowledge the fact that assembly theory is exact in molecules. And part of the reason for that is because molecule space is actually easier to articulate, but also because you measure assembly in molecules. And I'll talk about that in a few minutes. But also because of the way that we actually look for alien life right now. So for example, flying NASA missions, I mentioned phosphine earlier, phosphine on Venus, the sort of major markers of life on other planets that space missions are looking for are molecules. So it's important, if you want a theory for what life is, a theory that can explain both the origin of life and look for alien life, it has to have some connection to chemistry, because chemistry is where life emerges. We are chemical in our deep history. And chemistry is also how we look for life. And chemistry is this first place where we see this combinatorial explosion. So I want to explain what assembly is for a molecule called ATP, and how we talk about measuring assembly. And then I'm going to talk a little bit more about the deeper theoretical ideas before I get to sort of the experimental stuff. And then we'll talk about where it's going. So this is ATP, so the way we build an assembly space, you take a molecule, and if you break it in half, and you break it in half again, you break those pieces in half, break them in half again, you'll get to elementary building blocks. Those elementary building blocks in assembly theory are actually bonds. And then you can look at all the ways that you can reassemble that molecule. So there's a lot of different paths. If you're easier time imagining building, I don't know, a Lego castle rather than a molecule. Imagine you take the Lego castle all the way down to the building blocks, and then you try to build the Lego castle up every different possible way you could build it. That's what we call an assembly space. And then what we look for is, what's the shortest path in that space? So what's the shortest number of operations of joining two Lego blocks together or two bonds together to actually build up that original molecule? And that number is actually really significant because it tells us something important about the complexity of that object. We call that molecular assembly. So this says PA because originally it was pathway assembly. But for ATP, that's 21 steps. So you need a minimum of 21 operations to make a molecule of ATP in an assembly space. And the reason this is significant is if that complexity is higher, it takes more and more steps, it requires more and more specificity to produce that particular object, because you need more and more information. Each step, you could make an error. And it's a combinatorially exponentially a growing space, right? So remember, chemical space is huge, and every time I add an atom, I have more and more combinatorial possibilities of the number of objects that could be identical in atomic, like, you know, the stoichiometry, the number of different elements, but different in their actual 3D conformation of that object. So to get that specific object requires a lot of specificity. And so assembly theory, assembly index, is trying to quantify how complex the object is, how much information is required out of that combinatorial space of exploding possibilities to get that specific object. So I'm going to get abstract for a few minutes, and then I'm going to go concrete again. I know this whole talk's been abstract, but I like to think that way. It's fun for me. I like abstract things. But the way we talk about things in assembly theory is everything you observe is actually an object in an assembly space. So I'm not Sarah. I'm in an assembly space that's 4 billion years old. My assembly index is very high. All of you in the audience took a very long time for the universe to construct you. The universe had to make planets and stars, and it had to make stars first, and then it had to make planets, and then the planets had to have a certain combinatorial chemistry on the surface of the planet, and then it had to invent cells, and those cells had to evolve for many billions of years before they became multicellular, and then they grew into societies and things, right? So it takes a lot of time to construct an object like us in the universe. And what assembly theory is saying is that every observed structure that you observe in the universe has a particular path length associated to it, all the way back down to fundamental building blocks, which is this assembly index. And it's telling you something about the existence of that object in time. So this is actually making time a physical attribute of an object. We measure objects in terms of their physical size. We measure objects in terms of their mass. Assembly theory is saying objects exist across time. I like Michael Lockman's thing. I don't know how old Michael is, but he always says he's like, 3.8 billion years old, because that's when life emerged on the planet, right? So we're a lineage. He looks good for his age. But here we are sitting 4 billion years. We're 4 billion year old things. And so the way that we would quantify this whole sort of idea that information has been structuring matter across time is to say each of these objects is an assembly space, and the assembly index, or the assembliness, I'll talk about that in a minute, it's slightly different than the assembly index, has been increasing as a function of time. Because we're building more complex objects. We have more information in our biosphere as a function of time to build more and more complex objects. But it's not something that happens spontaneously. It requires the history of former objects being built before it. And I'll talk in a minute about why I have the origin of life transition around an assembly index of 15. But this is sort of the picture we're trying to build as far as how it relates to the evolution of the biosphere. And then the way that you should think about this from a fundamental physics perspective is to think about the universe, at least when we get to chemistry, as this structure, an assembly space, of the relationship between different objects. So each object actually has a relationship to other objects. So my assembly space has a lot of overlap with everyone else in this room because we have a lot of common history, right? So we're not actually very unique objects. We have a lot of common causal history. But we're distinguished at a certain level. So you might think of like these as different people or different animals that have emerged in the evolution of history, but they're united in the past in a common structure. And the interesting thing about thinking about this assembly space structure is that we can think about different levels of specificity as far as explaining what actually exists. So if you just took, you know, those elementary building blocks, say the atoms in the periodic table, and you randomly combine them, and you say, I can randomly combine everything forever, you're going to have a doubly exponentially growing process of possibility space. And that's not actually what we observe. We don't observe everything existing. We only observe some things. And so what we're saying with assembly theory is that there's actually causal constraints that emerge because of the history that came before. And so if you start actually looking at the fact that objects have common history, they have common assembly structure, and the things that can come in the future are dependent on that common history, so there's a historical contingency, the length of time matters as far as predicting what can come next, then you actually get these different sets of constraints that explain why not everything that could exist does exist, but why you see a particular set of things existing. And assembly observes means that we just go based, we don't start from an initial condition and apply some fixed law. We look at what we actually have existing now, and we look at the structure of it in terms of the causal history of the creation of those objects and the overlap in that history, and we use that as an explanatory framework for what's happening now and what exists now. So if you look at something like a graph, so these are supposed to be sort of abstract, but these are things like molecules. These are assembly pathways. So these are, remember the Lego building blocks, like if you imagined your castle and you started building, I don't know, the chimney first or something, and then you built a window, you know, these would be parts of the assembly structure. If you're making a car, you would have a motor, and you know, you stick the wheels together. So you can make all kinds of different objects that are related by reusing components, and they might be related deeper in time for some objects. So for P3 and P1, they're much more deeper in time than P2 and P1. And so we can start talking about the structure of these assembly spaces actually constraining the features of what we observe in terms of this shared common history. And so it's a way of actually talking about embedding what we've canonically talked about as relations among the tree of life, for example, that all species on Earth are created by a common ancestry, but making that concept much more general. It doesn't necessarily require that you know the specific lineage of genomes, for example. You could apply this to technology, you can apply it to language, you can apply it to collective behavior, you can apply it to morphology, and you can apply it to AI, because all it talks about is what is the actual physical structure of this object as you would assemble it across time, and can I use that attribute of its assembly across time as a physical feature of that system? And the relationship between those things is a measure of how related they are and how much they can generate. Yeah. Okay, thanks. I know I'm running long, wow, okay. I'm gonna just say, so we have this idea that it's not just about the assembly index, but it's actually about the copy number, and this is captured by quantifying assembliness. So it's not just that you have a single object that emerges in the universe that's high complexity, requires evolution or information to produce it, but you have many similar objects. And this is one of the reasons that we say that it was produced by a reliable process. Remember my example of the satellites. Satellites are interesting, not because they're a one-off event, but because we have the knowledge to produce them again and again. And so we have this idea of assembliness capturing both assembly index and this copy number, that this has become a reliable process in the universe to kind of quantify this physics. So I mentioned that this is exactly measurable in molecules. So we do that with mass spec. So this is all data from Lee Cronin's lab. But if you measure the peaks in an instrument called a mass spectrometer, which is a way of measuring properties of molecules, there's a direct correlation between the number of peaks in the mass spec and what you actually measure for the molecular assembly index of the molecule. So this is just building up a molecule and showing how it contributes to actually calculating that assembly index, how much evolution is required or how much information required to build that object. And so assembly theory has actually been validated as a life detection system because you can measure assembly of molecules. Remember I said assembly is exact in molecules. You can measure it in a mass spec. And so this is data, again, from Lee's lab. But the important feature I want to note is I mentioned this origin of life transition, how much assembly goes into making an object. The origin of life happens around 15. And then you actually require this kind of quote-unquote new physics, this idea of assembly and causal constraints and history and time dependence becoming important at assembly index of 15 because you're now in the domain of living physics. because the possibility space is too large that you require those kinds of explanations to describe it. So what this data is showing is basically for non-living samples, you only see molecules with assembly index below 15. And when we actually look at biological samples, we see molecules, complex structures with higher assembly index, which means we've moved into that domain of physics. It's important to note that assembly theory is observationally validated with mass spec because it means we can go look for alien life on other worlds, because NASA and other space agencies fly mass spec instruments when they're going to look for life. So this is Enceladus, a moon of Saturn. It's one proposed target for future life detection missions. And so the idea that you could actually measure how much causal history, how much evolution or information is in an object is a really interesting proposal as a novel way of thinking about detecting life, not just looking for the molecules of life as we know it, because this allows us to go into different spaces of what's possible on other planets, not just what evolved on our planet. So I'm going to wrap up by talking about technology, because I mentioned theories are really important, explanations are important, but so is the pace of technology with explanations. So the example I gave was Einstein's theory of relativity in 100 years to develop the interferometer. So what are we doing now that will allow us to build the technology that allows us to see ourselves or see alien life? So I mentioned how can we see what's really there with two examples. And I think, you know, there's all kinds of other examples, right? So we have seismometers that allow us to feel the Earth because we can't feel earthquakes unless they're really intense, right? But we have instruments that are sensitive to that. So we pretty much outsourced almost all of our senses to different forms of technology. And what we're doing right now is outsourcing actually how we think to technology. I mentioned with the invention of computation, we built computers which are based on the architecture of how we think we mentally process things. And now we have neural networks, which are based on the idea that we can simulate in a computer the functions of human minds, potentially. And I think AI are interesting as a technology, you know, for all the things that we already talk about, but also because they might be the technology that allows us to see ourselves, actually allows us to see the physics of life. Because we have to build a system intelligent enough to, in the sort of framework I'm proposing, to actually see the structure of an assembly space, right? We couldn't see microbes. We couldn't see gravitational waves. We can't see ourselves as objects extended across time. What's the technology that's going to allow us to do that? And perhaps artificial intelligence and the kind of things that we're building in our computers are going to help. As far as the experiments, you know, I use a lot of physics analogies. We can simulate the origin of the universe in the Big Bang. We built a Big Bang simulator. If we want to study the biological build Big Bang, we need to simulate the origin of life, which means we need a planet simulator, because origin of life is an event that happens in our universe on planets. And so the technology is also being developed like this with the digitization of chemistry. And you can imagine building something that can simulate many planets and explore chemical space digitally with robotic chemistry to explore the space of what's possible and actually evolve alien life on Earth in the laboratory in the same sense that we build large experiments in particle physics. So I'm going to conclude with two quotes. I know I'm kind of over time here. So one is, all fiction that does not violate the laws of physics is fact. So when I think of things about like simulating a planet or new laws of physics and things like that, they are things I can imagine. They do not violate the laws of physics. They're not fact yet, but we do know that ideas, like the idea of planes or rockets that existed in the past, can become fact in the future. And the important thing about thinking about alien life is the crucial data cannot even be obtained until a theory tells us what to look for, how, and why. And I think this is what we're missing in thinking about alien life. First contact is not going to be with an event. We were not convinced by UAPs. We were not convinced by the President of the United States standing on the lawn of the White House saying that we found microbes in a meteorite. We're going to be convinced by an explanation, because explanations, theories, ideas with broad explanatory reach are the only thing that transform the future. And so if we want to answer, are we alone, we need to figure out what is the explanation for what are we. And with that, I'm going to thank my amazing collaborators. And I'm sorry for running a little long, but thank you all for being patient. And thank you all.
Question?
Thank you.
Hello? Testing? Hello? Can you hear me?
You all can hear me?
Doesn't seem. Hello? Great. All right, so you will see myself and a colleague with a microphone, and if any of you have questions, we might not be able to get to all of them, but please, if you have any questions, raise your hand and we will come to you.
I'm curious about the relationship of entropy to the manifestation of things in your system.
Yeah, so I think there is an approximation in assembly that you could get entropy if you had objects that had zero assembly, like they weren't assembled. And so I think this is kind of an interesting thing, is because we don't think of elementary particles or particles in a gas as objects that have history and they don't have causal relationships between each other because they don't have a common history, that we kind of coarse-grained all that information out in standard physics. And then we talk about something called entropy, which applies, you know, to ensembles. But then we apply it to, like, exact systems, and there's a lot of flaws with that approach. And I think what assembly gives us is sort of an exact theory that applies, you know, based on how differently assembled objects are, and we might be able to recover entropy if you have non-assembled objects.
Here, let's see if there's one in the back, center. I'm coming. I'm sorry.
Thank you. That was a fabulous talk.
Thank you.
It seems as though most of your focus right now is on life as a physical chemical mm-hmm. system. You also talked about information quite a lot. And I'm wondering if you have any thoughts on how you would apply ideas of assembly theory to systems where the physical manifestation, e.g. in a computer, mm-hmm. stays exactly the same, even though the information configuration and dynamics in it can be changing and evolving, even though if you look at it as a physical system, it remains essentially totally unchanging.
Yeah, so I think that's a misnomer, actually. So, I mean, I've really struggled with this because most of my career I've been the person arguing, like, information is the thing and we need to focus on abstractions. But I think it becomes really problematic because we don't know how to talk about those things. And so in assembly theory, if objects are different, they have a different assembly structure. But the things that we talk about as information, you know, like two objects looking different, would actually be because of the structure of those assembly spaces being slightly different, if they had different information in them. So it's a little bit more than I can get into because it's kind of an idea still in the works. But the way I think about information as like an entity that exists in our world and the way we describe it is actually to try to think not about it as a pattern in space, which is the way we usually talk about it, but as part of the structure of an assembly space in time. So we don't always see all the features of that as a physical object because we don't account for the fact that those objects are embedded in history. So even, for example, people want to model life in cellular automata, and they look at the rules of cellular automata and see all these emergent patterns, and they say, oh, well, those simple rules gave us emergent patterns. But those computers don't exist without an evolutionary history, and they don't exist without the boundary conditions of the programmer making that program. So all of that contingency is already embedded in the creation of that information in that system. And I think that part of the reason that information looks so abstract for us is because we're not accounting for the fact that it's a physical feature of objects as they exist across time. And I don't know a more articulate way to say that right now because it's in development, but that would be, I guess, the shortest answer I can give.
I want to add my thanks as well for a great talk. This is a naive question, but could you explain where the Urey Miller experiments failed and how they fit into this?
Of course. So the Urey Miller experiment is one of the most famous experiments in origins of life chemistry. It was done in 1953 by then PhD student Stanley Miller. And what he did was basically put some simple compounds in a glass container, and he subjected lightning to it and had it under sort of reducing conditions believed to be characteristic of the primitive atmosphere of early Earth, and he saw amino acids being produced. And so this was a monumental experiment at the time because no one had tried to do a simulation of early Earth to produce molecules that are found in biology. And so a lot of people thought actually that it would just be weeks before life forms were crawling out of a Miller-type experiment. And of course, we haven't seen that since. Where that fits here is, I think one of the things that's been really interesting in the origin of life field generally is everybody has their sort of molecules that are present in life that they want to produce in their lab. And so they might make an amino acid, or they might make some bases associated with RNA, for example, and they'll have to manipulate the conditions of the experiment to produce them. But there's not sort of a general effort of embracing the mess of the geochemistry of the planet and trying to understand how is it that life emerges from that mess, because it's been experimentally very intractable. And so the part I kind of quickly ran over at the end, because I was running out of time, was really about this idea of trying to start with ensemble experiments where you have lots of different kinds of chemistry and you're trying to manipulate changing different geochemical conditions and then looking for high assembly objects emerging out of different kinds of histories and then trying to say which kinds of histories are more likely to funnel the trajectory toward what we would call living physics by building more complex molecules in some kind of evolutionary process. And that's the way I think origin of life experiments need to be done. But the challenge with any origin of life experiment is the experiment itself is the product of 4 billion years of evolution, because you are an agent that evolved in the universe and you're now building an experiment and controlling the boundary conditions. And so every time, even with the Miller-Urey experiment, you have a round bottom flask, you add a purified reagent, you add a lightning thing, each one of those is a bit of information you're adding to the experiment. And so what we're trying to do, and this is really Lee Cronin's vision, I mean, he's the experimentalist and he's just absolutely a genius on the set of stuff that he's trying to do in his lab. And he's got an incredible team working with him. They're basically trying to figure out how to build robots to explore as much of chemical space as possible and do it agnostically and quantify how much information you put in. It's like assembly in versus assembly out is basically what we're looking for. We want to know exactly how much constraints, because assembly quantifies the constraints to produce that specific object. How many did you put in, and how many did the physics of the universe give you out of that particular experiment because you had the particular conditions to actually generate the constraints within the experiment to make high complexity objects? And that's where I think origin of life needs to go for experiments, because we're over-engineering everything. We're putting too much agency in.
I think we have time for one more question.
Yeah, I'm not quite sure how to ask the question, but you're kind of describing this evolution of complexity of the structure of these molecules, right?
Yeah.
But sometimes something could have more structural complexion, but functionally it's not. So you can have a much more complicated sequence to make DNA or a simpler version, but it's still functionally the same. So it seems like there's a discrepancy between the functional unit as a unit versus the structural unit.
Yeah, so there's an interesting dichotomy in that we're not actually, so the way we talk about it right now, everything about function has been kind of removed, or everything about meaning or semantics or all the sort of typical debates that we have in trying to understand the nature of life. And for me, that's a little bit challenging, but I also think that's the way we have to go, because there are certain philosophical concepts and ideas we've carried for a long time, and they, you know, like some of the world's brightest minds have been working on them and they haven't solved it. So my perspective on those kind of things is always, well, maybe we should just, you know, tunnel out of that approach and try to think about it from a different angle. So in assembly spaces, what we think about is, you don't go on, I'm going to start from here and try to get from there. You look at the objects that you actually have. I have a molecule, and you say, was it necessary that the universe had some kind of information processing system or evolutionary process or whatever words you want to label it for this object to actually even exist that I can detect it? And the mass spectrometer I didn't mention, actually, it doesn't detect a molecule unless there's 10,000 copies. So this is, again, that copy number. It's high complexity, plus you have a lot of copies, which suggests that you must have had a machine that knew how to make that object, or you had an architecture to make that object. So in some ways, we don't even care about function. We just care that there was a function that had to exist to produce that object. And so in some ways, it's coarse-grained out the action of us as constructors or objects that are doing the actual transformations and saying, would this thing be possible without something like that existing? And there is an open philosophical question. I'm debating this quite a bit with my group right now about how to put the idea of a constructor or a functional thing back into the theory. Like, what does that do? But I think all of that requires reframing, actually. And that's one of the things I'm struggling with now, because I've always been the person talking about information and constructors and function stuff as being the thing that life is doing. And I think it's captured in the theory. It just looks really different. But most of the time when we get to new ideas, they look totally different than when you started. So I find that a good feature.
Okay, I'm going to allow Penelope to ask one last question, if that's okay. She's right here in the front.
Yeah.
Does consciousness and the origin thereof have a place in your brilliant presentation?
Thanks. Yeah, I didn't. You can't cover everything in one talk. I think a lot about consciousness. And again, I kind of have a more pragmatic view of it. So, you know, usually when people are thinking about consciousness, we're always kind of worried about the problem of experience, right? So that's the hard problem of consciousness. Why does it feel like anything to be in the room right now? And why, you know, this is a very visceral thing. And for me, when I think about consciousness, I think if consciousness is a real physical thing, it's a real thing that exists in our universe, it's not an illusion. It must do something. And then I ask, well, what are the features of things, like what are the features of what can be generated in that space of possibility if there are agents, things that have experience? And that leads me to thinking about imagination as being kind of the key signature of consciousness, which is from an outside perspective. So we do something that's really interesting. So biology evolved to remember its history and use its history to do things. But we actually have access to things that have never existed. We imagine worlds that never existed, and then we generate things that exist in our universe that are consistent with our laws of physics based on that imagined worlds. So I gave the example of planes and things like, you know, rockets. And I think that's a huge function of what we are as conscious agents and what the sort of role of, it's almost like the universe has a sort of constrained history of a set of things, and then suddenly when you get to the level of complexity where you have enough history that you can generate consciousness, you have this huge past assembly space, that there's all of this creativity that can be generated because now you have this access to this entire, this space that's larger than the number of things that can exist, because they exist across time. I don't know. Time has to become a real physical thing, and I think that's actually the main challenge of assembly to current theories of physics is, now you have to say causal structure and time are the most fundamental thing in the universe, and then all the other things come out of that. But I think consciousness plays a really important role, and I think it's very deeply related to the physics of life. And I think people have separated those problems. Actually, Caitlin was saying this before. You know, like we think of them separate. They're not separate. They might not be separate. So I think they might be manifestations of same physics. Sure. Thanks.
Could we have one final round of applause for the incomparable Sarah Walker? Thank you all for coming. Yeah.